And good morning. Welcome to the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community Committee for Wednesday, May 5th, 2021. We are here on Treaty 1 territory, and I want to acknowledge that we are on traditional territory of Treaty 1 in the homeland of the Métis Nation that I have the privilege of living on. I also acknowledge the traditional territory of Indigenous ancestors and Shoal Lake First Nation number 40, which is a primary water source for Winnipeg and continues to have a boil water advisory. I also want to acknowledge that the three of us councillors, myself as Councillor Santos, Councillor Edie, and Councillor Sharma, today we wear pins that we received from the North End Women's Center, which is located in Councillor Edie's ward, in recognition of the National Day of Awareness for Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women, Girls, plus 2S. I want to make sure that I have that correct. I also want to acknowledge we have people from the Winnipeg Public Service, Mr. Peter Prinzu, who's our senior committee clerk, and Mr. Rack here, who's the planner from the Planning, Property and Development Department. I will go straight into delegations. Peter?
We'll actually need a motion for the minutes first.
Yes. Thank you. Go ahead. Okay, Councillor Edie moves a motion from the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Committee from last month. The date was, remind me again.
April 13th.
April 13th. Okay, excellent. Okay, so moved. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And that's carried. Okay, we'll move into delegations. Our first one that we have up is Inspector Lutz from the Winnipeg Police Service to be heard with respect to police matters. Do we have him online? We do. Excellent.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Inspector. How are you?
Very good. Very good.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Today, I'm going to, we spoke not too long ago, so I'm not going to go over through our statistics so much today. I just wanted to highlight a couple of incidents. Obviously, there was a news release on Tuesday, April 20th, with respect to Project Matriarch, which was done in conjunction with our drug enforcement unit. A number of our district's three CSU members were part of a joint task force with the drug enforcement unit. And this project started with the assistance of some, you know, local activists, neighbors, concerned neighbors, and citizens in the Point Douglas area. And then a lot of work was done by District 3 members and the District 3 CSU members sort of to get this project going, because it was a big problem in the neighborhood there, Point Douglas. So with all that information, we garnered the assistance of the Drug Enforcement Unit, and Project Matriarch was started in, I guess it would have been sort of the fall of last year of 2020. And with that, a series of arrests were ultimately made over 26 people arrested. And a bunch of proceeds of the crime were seized, including 10 residential properties. And, you know, the totality of all that, there were 100 charges laid, over $2.3 million in seized property and evidence seized. And we're hoping this is going to take a big bite out of the drug trafficking in that area and the surrounding area. And with obviously that reduction, there'll be a reduction in the gang violence that usually is associated to those types of crimes. So that was sort of a big thing. We were kind of sitting on, obviously we couldn't discuss it earlier because of confidentiality issues and you know, the safety of our members and that sort of thing. But you know, I'm really proud of our members for the work they did on that. I think it's really going to take a bite out of crime in that area. We're going to continue to stay in that area and work diligently to ensure that they don't, that group doesn't get re-established in that Point Douglas area. And that'll be an ongoing commitment, you know, through the summer and going forward. So I don't know if anybody has any questions about that, some of which I don't know that I'll be able to answer necessarily, but I can certainly try if there are any questions before I get into sort of some of the crime trends we've had over the past months, just generally in the division.
Deal with it when questions.
Okay, we'll deal with it. We'll ask questions afterwards. You can continue on with your presentation. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm just going to go over some of the crime trends. We spoke not too long ago, and statistically, you know, we've moved forward on some of our enforcement initiatives, but recently, just for people in the community, we've seen a plateau in incidents over the last months just because of COVID restrictions and such. It's sort of kept our numbers, you know, very, very consistent. But there was an increase in arsons over the last couple of weeks, and those are currently under investigation. And as well, there's been an increase in some of the break and enters over the last couple of weeks in the Scotia Heights area. And an arrest was made by our members here, so hopefully that'll calm down. But obviously in the spring, with some of, you know, some spring cleaning and whatnot, I think some people are still leaving some garbage in their back alleys and whatnot, and those things are easily, you know, caught on fire, that sort of thing. So it's not uncommon to see that in the spring. All right, so with that, does anybody have any questions?
Okay, Councillor Edie has a question.
Certainly.
Yeah, first I just want to express my great appreciation which you will hear from the community in which you spoke of, in which a major drug operation was basically shut down. And I just wanted to say, because I don't think your officers and your community support and everybody, I don't think the people understand how well that the police service and the community can work together to resolve. And basically that issue that was cleaned up finally has been going on for like almost like 15 years, two decades, and off and on, although there is a lot more. But I just wanted to publicly state that, you know, this demonstrates how the Winnipeg Police Service, and especially, well, I'm sure it's the same everywhere, but how the police service can work really well with community and serve to the common purpose to make sure that everybody is safe and respected and can enjoy their neighborhoods. So I just wanted to state that publicly. And I know that's the feeling of the community in which the police service has worked with there. So I just wanted to say that. And it sounds like you're going to be diligent, because given that illegal trade, vacuums are created, and I think it'll be important to be diligent to stay on top of goings on in that regard, because, you know, sad to say, there are a lot of people who are living with addictions in the area. And anyway, we have to be diligent to ensure things are good. And I know the police service will, because it sounds like you have a plan. I really have a question. Sorry, I get a little offended when I hear Scotia. Scotia Heights is a real estate market designation. I was going to ask you today, just like, apparently there's a particular person, I think, who has done what I've been called, essentially, is what is a home invasion and theft. And I know that they've been caught on video, but I just, like, I'm getting calls, like, I don't know what to do about it, because, I mean, you can have a community patrol, But the problem is, this stuff is happening like in the wee hours of the morning. And people are in the community, and I live in Seven Oaks neighborhood and just up Scotia. And I know that my family, you know, we're locking doors now and everything, which, you know, we never had to really worry about that. But is are you designating this as a hot spot, a hot area in trying to deal with this? Because like I say, it is in the wee hours of the morning that this stuff's happening.
Yeah, so we're, you know, we're looking, we're keeping an eye on it. Obviously, you know, it takes a bit of time to develop a trend per se. But, you know, we have seen that rise. And as such, you know, depending on the nature of it. So we're wondering if this arrest we made is not going to, you know, certainly slow that activity down, or is it going to consistently, is it more than, you know, one sort of thing? So we're continuing to monitor it. And if you have any more information, or if these things are continuing, by all means, you know, throw me an email with whatever information you have, and I'll make sure our people are on it.
Well, you have made an arrest.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's what I said. We've made an arrest there.
It was one particular individual who was caught on video camera and all kinds of stuff. So,
yeah. Yeah. Okay. So, you know, we've had that 2-week spree, and we do had made an arrest on it. So, you know, it's kind of a wait and see now, like we're still monitoring it, but you know, we're kind of hoping that might be the end of it. Right. So.
Well, that's actually good news.
Yeah. Well, I try to give you good news, Council Lady, like, you know, I'm doing my best there. So.
Thank you. My questions.
Yeah.
You're good. Okay. No further questions. Thank you for coming again. We really appreciate the time you take.
Yeah, certainly. And as always, if anybody has any questions, comments, concerns, or anything that can help us do our job better, just send me an email. I'll make sure it gets to the right people, and we'll get on it as quickly as we can.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Take care, everybody.
Thank you. I just want to do a bit of a correction for this morning's announcement. I just noticed in my inbox, there was an email from Jessica Paley. They made a mention that they recently met with the West Central Women's Resource Center in Winnipeg, and that they shared an honor today, May 5th. And they were the ones that handcrafted the red dress pins that we are wearing today, made of repurposed leather. And that they will be handing it out to community members, provincial MLAs, to show their support of Red Dress Day. So we were gifted these. Each of the city councillors were gifted, and so was the mayor. I know some of us are probably working remotely and may not have access to it, but if you could show your support by wearing red or hanging a red dress in your window today, it would be greatly appreciated. So I just wanted to correct it, because I think I said North End Women's Center, but it was not. Okay. Yes, excellent. Okay, so we do have a number of delegations registered for item number 2 on our agenda today, plan approval 920 Jefferson Avenue, file DAZ322/79. We've also received a number of submissions on the matter late yesterday that speaks to legal matters and raises some jurisdictional concerns. As such, the committee will not be hearing delegations on the matter today, and it's my understanding that the committee will be referring the matter to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development, Heritage and Downtown Development for their consideration.
Thank you. With that, Madam Chair, I'd like to ask the committee to deal with item 2 at this time. We can just change the order. And I'd like to move a motion.
Okay. Yeah, no problem.
Okay. Thank you. I'd like to move that the plan approval, 920 Jefferson Avenue, file DAZ322/79, be referred to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development, Heritage and Downtown Development for consideration. In accordance with sections 15.1 and 58 of the Development Procedures Bylaw, 104 of 2020. And I'd like this item to be placed on the next meeting agenda if possible.
Okay.
My motion, Madam Clerk.
Okay.
Madam Chair.
Yeah. Motion's on the floor. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? And that's carried. All right. We'll go into the next report, which is honorary street name designating Quelch Street between Logan Avenue and White Avenue as Cantor Way. If I can ask Councillor Edie to take the chair, I'd like to speak to this.
I'll take the chair. Yes.
Excellent. Thank you.
I wonder where Kat is.
Yes. So our office has been reached out by the local community. And they wanted to do an honorific street name. So working with the community, it's been a quite a going back and forth because of COVID. We've had some issues with communications, but I'm excited that this report is here as before us today. I want to say that Cantor's Meat is a proud North End institution, home of quality meats and superior services. Cantor's has been serving generations of Winnipeggers and beyond since the opening in the early 1940s. Cantor's legacy began when Edward and Sarah Cantor brought their family, two sets of twins, to Winnipeg from Poland in the 1920s. Upon moving to Winnipeg, the Cantor family began their three-generation family business selling buttons, zippers, and thread to local farmers. In the early days, the entrepreneurial family also sold chickens and eggs door-to-door in the North End. Eventually, the business expanded to sell more products from the living room of their home on the corner of Dufferin Avenue and Salter Avenue, with the Cantor family living just above the shop. From the beginning, Edward instilled the value of customer service. Groceries were delivered in all Winnipeg weather via bicycle in the summer and sled in winter. Charge accounts were set up and trusting customer relationships were paramount. When Edward passed away in 1944, Sarah and the twin sons, Joe and Oscar, took over the family business. Remaining connected to their North End community, they moved the family business to a new Magnus Avenue location, growing to employ a staff of 10 and expanding to offer a full service meat department. Known for their high quality meats, competitive prices, and dedication to quality services, is no surprise that the business continued to expand in the decades since. Four expansions at the Magnus Avenue location, and eventually in 2009, with business bursting at the seams, Cantor's expanded to its present day location on Logan Avenue. From its humble beginnings to now 80 years later and nearly 60 employees and over 13,000 square feet of shopping space, Cantor's continues to be a community hub in the North End of Winnipeg, bringing people together through their quality products and exceptional customer service. So before us today, I have the public service report and recommending that Quelch Street between Logan Avenue and White Avenue be designated with an honorific street name called Cantor Way for a period not exceeding 5 years, commencing on the date of installation of the street sign or street topper. The funding for the application and the signage will be funded through the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community's Point Douglas Ward Allowance. I'm very excited to move this motion. We'll be looking forward to finding out a time, obviously with the COVID restrictions, with some difficulties in inviting my councillor colleagues here beside me, Councillor Edie and Councillor Sharma, as we all represent the North End of the city. And hopefully we can either have an unveiling or some photos appropriately. And I'm very excited to move this. Thank you.
Thank you. Did you want to make any comments?
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I join in Councillor Santos's excitement and want to thank her and commend her for taking the lead with community residents on this important initiative. She stated so many beautiful words on the record about the family, and I too have deep admiration for the Cantor family and the proud North End institution that they are. I think we know them well, and I look forward to joining you along with Councillor Edie, Councillor Santos, when we have this celebration. Thank you so much for your leadership on this.
And I'm going to call the question, but first I wanted to give my kudos again to Councillor Santos. It's about time We honor, actually, I just wanted to say, the Cantors is one of the great, this is in the Weston neighborhood, and up in the North End is a great place, and Cantors is one of the renowned butcher meat shops that people know of Winnipeg up in our area, north of down north and west of downtown. So I really appreciate this, and I've often had meals with meat and such from Cantor. So anyway, good job, Councillor Santos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried. Would you like the chair back?
Sure, I can take the chair back. I think that ends our day for reports, unless there's any new business arising. Nope. Okay, then we will recess. We do have a public hearing starting at 10:30 a.m. We'll see you back in 30 minutes. Good morning and welcome to the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community Committee. We are in the public hearing portion for Wednesday, May 5th, 2021. I want to quickly acknowledge that we're on traditional territory of the Treaty Number 1 and homeland of the Métis Nation that I have the privilege of living on. I also acknowledge the traditional territory of an Indigenous ancestors in Shoal Lake First Nation Number 40, which is a primary water source for Winnipeg and continues to have a boil water advisory. With me today is myself as the chairperson, Councillor Santos. I also have Councillor E and Councillor Sharma from the Winnipeg Public Service. I have our senior committee clerk, Mr. Peter Prinsloo, and our planner from Planning, Property and Development Department, Mr. Rack Hayer. I think that's it, right? And then we're going to the clerk for introductions, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. For a more in-depth overview of the public hearing process, and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing, please consult the public hearing process brochure, which is available on the City Clerk's Department website. Please note that all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the hearing have concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item one is a closing at Oak Point Highway, immediately north of and adjoining 200 and 250 Oak Point Highway under file DAC 1/2021. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, those registered in opposition, and those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. And just for the committee's benefit, I have not received anybody registered for this, including the applicant, so we only have the public service here today. Okay. So we have our planner, Mr. Rack Iyer, and Kathy Gagnon online as well.
Excellent. Thank you. Yes, we can get a summary from the administration, please.
If I can hand it over to Kathy.
Okay.
I'm sure she can speak to it.
And Kathy is, sorry, what's her title?
Good morning, councillors.
Morning.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. My title is Real Property Officer.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. Welcome.
All right. I facilitate the applications for opening and closings of public rights of way. In this particular matter, it's a little bit unusual. An application or a pre-application was circulated by the owner of 250 Oak Point Highway with respect to their plans specifically for their property. 250, yes. And as part of that, the city identified this portion of Oak Point Highway that is a legally opened right-of-way serves no public transportation purpose. So we identified it and said, okay, well, we'd like to see it closed. That's fairly typical in these types of situations. The unusual part is then we usually have it incorporated into the private development. But in this instance, the owners who made the pre-application are not interested in purchasing any portion of the land once it's closed, but they still were willing to submit the application and absorb the costs related to the closing. So that's why this is before you. Once the property, once the roadway is closed, it will be created two parcels that align with the adjoining properties at 250 Oak Point Highway and 200. The city will retain ownership of those two parcels until such time that as they can successfully negotiate sales to the adjoining property owners. Since submitting, writing the report, the owners at 200 Oak Point Highway have indicated a serious interest in purchasing the property that adjoins theirs, and Real Estate Branch has commenced negotiations with them. So we have a belief that that will conclude within, you know, the next few months. The other one will be at such time as a new owner of 250 Oak Point Highway is in place and interested in purchasing. Otherwise, the city will hold.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you. Any questions for the administration? Yes, Councillor Edie has a question for you.
I'm just trying to get a sense of this. Would this be basically around the southwest corner of where Oak Point comes into Brookside and Route 90 that eventually turns into King Edward?
Yes, I believe that is. It's now my sense of direction is, I think it's north of Selkirk at the intersection there. It would be hard to identify if you were just driving past it because you won't know that it's actually legally opened. It just happens to be that when they realigned or when whatever they did, they, for some reason, this little tiny portion was left as a legally opened right of way, even though it's not improved or anything. It just looks like private property, and that's why it's being closed now.
Okay. Yeah, I know. I was just trying to get a sense of where exactly it was located. I used to hang out at a truck stop along that piece there on that side of the road. So I was just
I think it's if I'm aware of the truck stop, that's where it still exists, like a co-op or something out there.
Yeah, it
might. I think it's closer to Selkirk Avenue.
Okay, thank you.
All right,
thank you. Any further questions? I don't have any questions. I just, it seems like to me it's just more of like a cleanup.
Correct.
Issues. Yeah. Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Would you like me to move it?
Since we have no delegations, nobody here, we can just continue on with motions. Councillor Edie, if you wouldn't mind moving that motion on my behalf.
Sure. No problem.
Thank you.
Okay, I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken, be conferred in and forwarded to the Standing Policy Committee on Property Development, Heritage and Downtown Development.
Excellent. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anybody opposed? And that's carried.
I think that's it.
Yeah.
That is the only one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. No. Good. Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council.
Thank you again for having us. Okay, so we're on to our next item number two. Mr. Clerk, if you can introduce it.
Yes, we're just going to quickly let everybody into the meeting. Item two is a subdivision and rezoning at 835 Notre Dame Avenue under file DASZ 10 of 2021 in accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw. This is a combined hearing and the following item will also be heard at the same time, namely, item three is a variance at 835 Notre Dame Avenue under file DAV 115709 2021B. Please note additional communications were received in support subdivision and rezoning at 835 Notre Dame. And we'll just ask anybody through WhatsApp and in accordance with the city. Thank you. Okay, please note that additional communications were received in support of the application after the agenda was published, which have been distributed to all members of the committee. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, those registered in opposition, and those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. All participants have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you have been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch live via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute your audio player now. And I will hand it over to our planner to give an overview on the matter.
Just before we do that, Madam Chair, if I just can clarify. Item two, it states that it's in the Daniel Mack board on the docket here. Is it in fact, Mr. Clerk, in the Point Douglas ward? I just want to be
yes. Clear.
Okay.
That is correct.
Okay, we'll just correct that then in the docket in the report on item two and three, it states the Daniel Mack ward. Thank you.
Thank you for clarifying that. Yes.
Thank you, everyone. So this is an application to consider the construction of a four-story mixed-use building at the corner of Notre Dame Avenue and Tecumseh Street in the West Alexander neighborhood and the Point Douglas ward. The property is currently zoned C2, and the applicant is proposing to rezone it to RMU, residential mixed use. And again, the intent is to construct a mixed-use building. It would have three commercial units on the main floor and 45 residential dwellings on the upper stories. The site falls within the boundaries of the West Alexander Centennial Neighborhood Secondary Plan area. It's designated as commercial policy area. Also associated with the subdivision and rezoning are some variances to lower the setbacks to the building, reduce the setbacks to parking, to permit the level of density that is being proposed, to lower parking requirements, and also to allow a fence height of 6.5 feet in the front yard. Project started in September of 2020 with pre-application. The applicant submitted an application to solicit feedback from the administration. A number of amendments were made to the plan as a result of that process. This includes lowering the building height. Initially, they proposed 5 stories. They lowered it to 4 stories. This was done to mitigate any impact of the building height on the residential properties north of the subject site. An indoor bicycle parking room was added as well in the residential lobby area. The main floor has been designed with glass and brick in order to provide an attractive streetscape along Tecumseh as well as Notre Dame Avenue. An accessible path of travel 5 feet wide was provided along the back of the building, connecting the back entrance to the sidewalk in Tecumseh, as well as providing accessibility to the parking area. Landscaping and screening was added to the parking lot in order to provide more buffering along the north lot line, where the site interfaces with single family dwellings to the north. The applicant also, at the direction of the division, did some public consultation. My understanding is that they sent out flyers to neighborhood residents. They engaged the West End Biz, as well as did a presentation to the University of Manitoba medical students, and submitted some letters of support as well. In terms of compliance with the secondary plan and the communities, it complies with a number of our policies. It adds density in a location that has access to transit. There's a bus stop on Notre Dame right in front of the main door to the lobby. It's within a 10-minute walk to most commercial amenities that neighborhood residents would need for their day-to-day needs. For instance, grocery stores, banks, pharmacies are all within walking distance. And the overall built form of the development is compatible with the context that surrounds this property. The building would be located very close to the Notre Dame and Tecumseh Street property lines. Specifically, it would be set back 0.5 foot from both Notre Dame and Tecumseh. Buildings with minimal setbacks are fairly common on this portion of Notre Dame Avenue. In terms of some of the other variances, in the interior side yard, which is on the west side of the building, they would have a 5-foot setback. And so that 5-foot setback would be between the proposed building and the existing commercial building north of the site, and a fence with a gate is proposed to sort of block that 5-foot path from the sidewalk. In terms of some of the other variances, we are supportive of all of the variances and are recommending approval. As mentioned, in support of the parking variance, they have added indoor protected and weatherproof bicycle parking. The site is, like I mentioned, in an area that's walkable, access to transit. It is also very close to major employment and educational hubs. The Health Sciences Center and the University of Manitoba are within walking distance, as well as it's in proximity to the bi-directional bike lanes that connect the subject neighborhood to the Exchange District. So it's about a 5 to 10 minute bike ride to downtown. And with that said, we are recommending approval of the application.
Excellent, thank you. Any questions before we go into presentations? No, okay, say none. All right, we can move right into hearing the delegation.
So first up, we have the applicant. Good morning, Warren. You have up to 10 minutes for your presentation beginning now.
Good morning, Peter. Can you hear me?
Yes, thank you.
Great, thank you. Good morning, councillors. My name is Warren Mills. I'm with you as the applicant on behalf of 1007-1038 Manitoba Inc., 835 Notre Dame Avenue. I'm joined with Karen Shansky, the principal of BLDG Architecture Office, the project architectural team, and Dr. Hossein Kashefi, a principal in the development company. We're here requesting your support to allow us to proceed with this project. The planner's report is fulsome and we certainly respect it. I have just a few comments and thoughts. A brief history of the property. In 1990, Shell closed a gas station and convenience store on this property. It was demolished and remediated. Since 1996, the property has served, as your planner notes, as an illegal gravel-surfaced parking lot. The property was purchased by the development team in the summer of 2020. We entered into the pre-application process and we're proud and wish to emphasize that, to be blunt, we listened. The pre-app process contributed significant admin input. We believe we've incorporated most all of it. Through that process, we heard the councillors' thoughts and concerns on bicycle storage, a thorough community consultation process, and that we reach out to and include the West End biz, and we have incorporated all of that. We've paid attention to our Winnipeg and the West Alexander and Centennial Neighborhood Secondary Plan. Karen can speak to those points. We entered into, despite COVID, what we believe was a thorough community consultation process. We produced a color project brochure that we hand delivered to 90 residential mailboxes and 20 adjacent businesses. We established a project-specific webpage and a project-specific email. Excuse me. We received community comments, 9 points of feedback from the community. 8 of them were positive, and 1 listed general community concerns. We've shared all of those with your administration. I'll ask Karen to speak to the building design and those qualities. And if you have any further questions or thoughts, we'd be pleased to speak to them.
We'll wait for our questions afterwards. Go ahead, Karen. You're on mute, Karen. Yeah.
Yep. Okay, great. I'm actually just going to share my screen if that's permitted. There we go. Great. I just thought I'd take some time just to sort of generally describe what we have here in terms of, and we're really excited about this project. It's an amazing opportunity for us to actually provide a really neat compact urban infill project on an existing parking lot, whether it be sort of clandestine or not. But as you can see, the building is actually quite tight to Notre Dame and Tecumseh Avenue. And again, this is an intentional positioning of this commercial corner, again, to sort of reinforce that character along Notre Dame, where the buildings do actually come to a zero lot line across the Notre Dame front. In terms of the variances, when we refer to the taller fence, it is about sort of limiting people from coming along that 5-foot side yard here. So we've included these taller fences, and again, this is for security around the building. If I just move here, this shows how the footprints of the main floor of the building would set up. We have our primary entry for the residential component of the building, which is on floors 2, 3, and 4. So that is again on the west side of the building. This is the inclusion of the interior secure bicycle parking that was included after consultation and discussions with Councillor Santos. And again, it's a great addition. There is also exterior, more temporary bike parking that is underneath the overhang of the building here on the west, on the east side. The three CRU units currently in this plan, they're shown as the ability to actually have three distinct units, but there is a proposal already for 2 and 3 becoming clinic space and pharmacy. So again, the commercial component is already going to be full with high quality services that are going to support the neighborhood. The footprint along Notre Dame is quite narrow, but then this provides for all of the provided parking, both for the commercial units and for the future residents, to be tucked in behind this sort of narrow commercial building. And then this is the new approach, slightly modified from the location of the existing approach off of Tecumseh. There will be no access off of the back lane to the north. This will only be for garbage pickup. And again, a contained garbage enclosure as per bylaw. The typical floor plate up above, again, we have 15 units per floor, and then these are going to actually provide a really good mix of different suite types, from 2-bedroom, 1-bath, all the way down to smaller studio apartments. And again, the intention is that the residential component services a great need for some student housing, some people that work and live near the Health Sciences Center. In terms of the elevation, as it was sort of mentioned previously in presentations, so the main floor is going to be finished quite robustly. There's going to be storefront glazing going all the way from approximately 9 feet down to grade. So again, providing lots of natural light and inside outside for that commercial main floor. This is a quick elevation here that starts to describe the footprint of the building and the cantilever of the three stories of the residential units, which provides us to have sort of half covered parking, and then the balance of the parking closer to the fence on the north property line. This is an elevation of the north side. And I just wanted to finish with two renderings here. So these are, again, artist renderings of what the building would look like in situ in terms of the height. Just as a note, there are no balconies being proposed, but instead Juliet's. And then this also sort of responds to the residents to the north of the property in terms of sort of providing more privacy, but also again, this compact urban form. It's a much more urban block that sort of as it pushes up against the primary arteries. So we imagine that there could be our clinic space, our pharmacy, and then we're hopeful for maybe another more coffee shop, meet and greet activity happening in the last commercial unit once COVID goes away. That would be fantastic. So this sort of gives you the new streetscape, and we will be introducing planting, but again, the planting would be more set up in planter boxes, more urban planting landscape that would sort of sit within those niches to try and break up the facade. I think I will leave it at that. And I'm also happy to answer any specific detailed questions that Warren might not be ready to answer. Thank you.
Thank you. I also see the doctor. I don't know if you want to take this opportunity to say anything, or you're just, is he part of the presentation as well? I think you had about 3 more minutes left.
Sure. Yeah, just wanted to actually thank the committee for actually this opportunity for hearing us for this application. I don't have anything that Karen said everything, all of the technical basically aspects. No, I don't have anything, but just wanted to actually say, because a decade ago when I started actually as a student, I was looking for somewhere actually around to basically have a apartment or something to actually live with my wife. We couldn't really find anything. There was a medical student apartments just on the Emily and Notre Dame that was very, very outdated at that time. And we didn't really have any option. That inspired actually our group to have something to help the students and the community who are definitely in this actually neighborhood is just a very low income community. I know, and the students basically are low income. So we want to actually help the community with providing this kind of housing, affordable housing that can help both the community and the students and the Bannatyne campus students. That's all I wanted to say. And thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you. Any questions for our applicants here, councillors?
Sounds great.
I do. I can go after you or now.
No, you can go right ahead. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much for the detailed presentation. It's very detailed. We do appreciate that. Could you comment, and you may have already, on the timeline, the projected timeline of the project? You're muted, Warren. We can't hear you.
There, can you hear me?
Yes.
As we're all aware, the cost of construction materials is increasing almost daily. And we would like to move as quickly as we possibly can. Affordable housing with the rent structure that comes with it makes these projects arguably thin. And the current COVID construction supply chain issues are increasing the pain. And anything that this process can do to allow us to move quickly is greatly appreciated. If you could issue a building permit tomorrow, I think we'd be excited.
I don't think that's under our purview, but
I tried.
Certainly hear you on inflation that's occurred. Mm-hmm. That's hitting, it's difficult for projects when you've costed them out, you know, previously, and costs keep escalating. So we certainly hear you on that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Kashefi, could you explain a little bit more? I'm assuming these are going to be apartment style, not condos or outright. Oh, yeah. When you say you're supporting students affordable, I'm assuming they're apartments.
They're apartments. They are all rental apartments, 45 rental apartments, 1 and 2 bedrooms apartments that we are proposing.
And is it your idea to just rent it out to students only, or are you opening it up to other?
Not only the students, but all the community actually can benefit from this.
Excellent. All right. I don't think I have any other questions. It's a great honor for you guys having to redevelop a parking lot. I appreciate that, and reaching out to my office early on during the pre-application and discussing some of the issues around parking and landscaping, and definitely the bike enclosures. I really appreciate you incorporating that. I think that's a great amenity, especially being along a major arterial route like Notre Dame that offers transit. This is a great project. I'm really, really, really excited, and I appreciate you working with our planners, going back and forth and coming to a really good middle ground on your project. So with that in hand, Mr. Clerk, do we have anybody in opposition?
Yes, so we have nobody else registered in support. We do have Josie Dillon registered in opposition. So Josie, you have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation, starting now.
Hello, can everyone hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Hello, my name is Josie Dillon, and I represent the Dillon family, the owners and residents at 842 and 844 Winnipeg Avenue. Our property is one of the four who are directly affected by the development proposed by the applicant Warren Mills and the owner of 835 Notre Dame Avenue, Hossein Kashefi. A few points I think I should clarify. According to Warren Mills, there was a Shell station that was closed in 1990. That's incorrect. It was closed between 1998 and 1999. And the gravel parking lot that was owned by Leon A. Brown, that opened in the early 2000s. I'll continue with my presentation now. We only received notification of this proposed development because of the variance hearing sign placed by 835 Notre Dame by the City of Winnipeg approximately 2 weeks ago. We are opposed to the proposed development for a number of reasons as follows. Firstly, according to the city planner, Mr. Hare, the development as it currently stands is four stories high, the first being a commercial business, specifically two medical units and possibly a restaurant, we were told, and the remaining three stories residential rental units. The height and dimensions of the current development are out of character in this community. There are no businesses of this height on Notre Dame. Only hospital properties at the Health Science Center are three or more stories high. Furthermore, there are no commercial buildings of this height and dimensions that butt up against adjoining residential properties in this area like ours and like the other three properties involved. Secondly, due to the excessive height of the proposed development, it encroaches on the privacy of the four adjoining properties and towers over them, taking away from backyard privacy. This building will essentially be walling off the adjoining residences by creating an eyesore like the Berlin Wall. Thirdly, the two garbage bins, approximately 3 cubic feet large, are to be placed in the back lane and not on the actual property of 835 Notre Dame. This action poses a health and safety hazard and will impede and obstruct traffic flow. To further clarify, I have another four subpoints to explain this point. Subpoint one, the waste material produced by this development will contain medical waste since two medical units are being located at this site, as well as a possible restaurant. The proposed wooden enclosure of the garbage area at the back lane poses a fire risk. This exact area has been set on fire a number of times to the point where the fire spread to the adjacent hydro pole that was burnt all the way to a foot from the top of it, to the back corner of 835 Notre Dame, to our driveway and garbage, and also to the wooden fence that separated 835 Notre Dame and our property. As well, there was a number of hydrometers attached to our plywood sheet that were also severely burned. Subpoint two, there have been a number of fires set both to commercial and residential garbage bins and enclosures in this back lane on a number of occasions. As a result, the back lane and associated area have been deemed as a high fire risk area. Subpoint three, there are a number of commercial sized vehicles, including garbage and recycling trucks that currently have enough problems maneuvering down the back lane and side lane. Consequently, they continually reverse or drive into our residential driveway in order to turn into the corner where the back lane and side lane meet. And this is the exact same corner and area of the back lane where the garbage enclosure is to be located. Subpoint four, the Dillon resident is located right beside the proposed garbage area. We take half a step out of our driveway and the proposed garbage area is right there. As it is obvious from the previous health and safety concerns mentioned, my family's health and safety is at risk by placing the garbage in the back lane, as well as the stench and unhygienic conditions alone from medical waste and restaurant garbage located beside a private residence is most unacceptable. According to the city planner Hare, the applicant Mills, who represents the owner at 835 Notre Dame, Kashefi, they sought community approval for this development and sent out flyers and had community discussions. We are one of the major players who are involved here. We never received any such flyers, any such form of communication, either verbal or by mail from either the applicant or owner of this development. We find this fact quite disturbing and appalling since we are directly impacted by the proposed development. Furthermore, according to the city planner, no response was received from any of the properties directly affected. Those that submitted responses of support are not directly impacted by this development and are as far as 30 addresses away from this development or on the opposite side of Winnipeg Avenue. For all these reasons described, we, the Dillon family, oppose the proposed development as it stands. If the applicant owner wish to create the atmosphere of peace and a sense of belonging into community, and not simply one of coming into the area for the sole reason of making profit, often essentially rental property, we strongly suggest the concerns raised here are taken seriously. We are not opposed to a properly designed development if the proposed development is slightly modified. First, lower the height of the development so its character is more in line with the rest of the current businesses on Notre Dame in this area. Consequently, the privacy of the properties directly adjoining 835 Notre Dame can be maintained to some point. Second, the enclosed garbage space should be located on the property of 835 Notre Dame itself, beside the current commercial building on 847 Notre Dame, and not in the back lane or behind the four residences butted up against 835 Notre Dame. Third, because of the heightened fire risk in this area, we suggest that the owner should consult possibly a landscaper or a horticulturalist or a U of M botanist and get some information about less flammable herbs and shrubs. And that was a suggestion done by the City of Winnipeg Fire Department based on the recent rash of fires that was happening in the city. To conclude, we would like to say if the applicant had any serious notion of taking into account the concerns raised by my family, he would have truly attempted to obtain opinions from the adjoining residences that are directly and greatly impacted. From September 2020, when the development's draft application was initially submitted, to April 2021, we have received no correspondence or communication of any kind from either applicant or owner. Instead of the applicant spending time redesigning the building for maximum profit, he should have been concerned with the health and safety issues involved. Only after I registered in opposition to this development, the Senior Community Committee Clerk, Peter Prinsloop, said the developer would like to talk to me regarding this matter. Lastly, to each community member, I ask yourself, put yourself in the position we're in. Would you like to have a four-story towering building over your residence, taking away any sense of privacy from your home and yard? Would you like it at all? I don't think so. In addition, the glaring health and safety hazards of this development are evident. I'm sure neither the applicant nor owner of 835 Notre Dame would like to be living next to such a development. It appears once again more and more in an effort of designing and redesigning this development was solely for profit and not concern for anything else. Thank you.
Thank you. We do have questions. Councillor Eadie? Sure.
In listening to your presentation, are you saying you're representing adjacent properties on Notre Dame to this property, or are you representing your just to confirm, you presented as being resident on Winnipeg?
Yes, my family owns and lives. We own the property at 842 and 844 Winnipeg Avenue, and we own and live in this property.
Okay, so when you're referring, you were talking about adjacent private property. So the back lane is the right of way between your properties and the Notre Dame properties. Is that correct?
On Winnipeg Avenue, on there's four properties on Winnipeg Avenue that 835 Notre Dame butt up against. From their back area to our back lane, to our backyard. And those are the four properties I'm talking about.
So the
I'm
back
representing lane, myself.
Yeah, so the back, just for my confirmation, the back lane that's being referred to runs north-south, not east-west.
There actually is no back lane between our property and then 835 Notre Dame. How the alley and the back lane is situated, there's four properties, and they have no back lane access. It's a side lane that runs beside, like an L, like a capital L. The side lane runs along the side of my house, and the back lane then goes all the way down towards Arlington.
Great. So an L shape. Okay, good.
And so that the corner where the L is formed is where the garbage is to be located, and there's no actual road or any separation between the four adjoining properties and 835 Notre Dame, other than a fence. That's the only thing that separates everyone.
So just to clarify then again, so you're saying that the garbage bin is going to be on the back lane, and we'll get clarification from the administration, because part of applications is to consider plan to deal with garbage, but I'm not understanding how you're interpreting that the bin is actually going to be on the back lane. It looks
that's
like
what the city planner told me, Mr. Hare. It's going to be located on the back lane for back lane pickup.
Adjacent to the back lane. It will be on. It has to be on private property adjacent to the back lane. So
there's how the lot is right now. It's all fenced off from the back lane.
Okay, we'll get clarification. So, but okay. Essentially, have you actually, there are images of the design, but it sounds to me like you were adjacent to an illegal parking lot that kind of probably violated your privacy on Winnipeg.
Well, that's the parking lot that was established, and that's where the Shell station was. Whether it was illegal or not, I couldn't tell you that part, but it's been operating for a number of years. And that is the area where I said, like, the L forms, that corner. I spoke to Ravinder Hare, and he is the one who told me that it's going to be, the garbage will be placed at the back in that corner, that dead corner of the L for back lane pickup.
Okay.
And that's what I was told at that time.
Yeah, I'm just trying to get clarification about how offensive the commercial operation of the Shell store would have been to your properties along Winnipeg Avenue.
I'm the only one in the garbage is right going to be up against my property. As soon as I take a half a step out of my driveway, the garbage would be right there in the back lane.
All right, so that's in reference to the garbage, right? But I'm just saying the history of it is a commercial property.
Yeah, it was, the Shell station was designed differently than how they're suggesting. We have no problem with the commercial property. But however, the height is a concern and the garbage location in the back lane.
Okay, thanks. That's all the questions.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Okay, say none. Thank you for your presentation. Who do we have next, Mr. Clerk?
We have no other persons registered.
Okay, then we just go to the administration. Okay, questions for the administration? Yes. Yes, absolutely, please.
So, you know, back lanes are fairly narrow, and this will be the size of building that will probably require a 5 cubic meter size bin, which is a fair bit larger than the 3 cubic meter. Where approximately is it located on the property, and can you tell me or describe to me how it'll probably be a front loading garbage collection? How's that truck get access to that bin?
Yes, of course. So the garbage enclosure would be located on the private property. Access to the enclosure would require the truck to go down the back lane. As it was described, the back lane is an L shape. The truck would come down the north-south lane, load the bins, and then turn right and go west. The bin would be set back roughly almost 6 feet from the property line, from the back lane. And it would also be set back almost 7 feet from where that L corner is formed. So the actual placement of the bins would be well within the private property. They've designed it so that when the gates open, because it's required to be fully enclosed, so when the gates open, those gates would also still be within the private property. They wouldn't swing into the back lane.
Okay.
Yes.
So that's the back lane. What is the backyard offset for the building from this new proposed building back to the fence that seems to be the privacy fence between Winnipeg Avenue and Notre Dame?
So the total setback would be 40 feet. And so that's measured from the north property line to the north wall of the residential portion of the building. It is
40 feet.
It is a cantilever. So there is the commercial portion of the building is a bit narrower. So on the main floor, it's more than 40 feet. It's closer to 60 feet. But considering the residential wall to the north lot line would be 40 feet. And the building itself would be 4 stories in height. There's no variance required for height. I would note that property is zoned C2, so it's permitted. The height that's being proposed is already permitted. So there's no variance required for either the height or for the garbage.
Great. Good. Thanks.
Can you speak a little bit more on the height? You said there was no variances. What is the maximum allowed along this area under the secondary plan? What would the maximum height be allowed?
Well, for commercial properties, 49 feet is what the bylaw establishes. This property is zoned C2, so they would be permitted a maximum height of 49 feet. If they were to do a mixed-use building under C2, then it would be permitted 60 feet in height. They're proposing to rezone it to RMU. They haven't requested any variance to the height. RMU does allow for a 100-foot tall building, but that's not what they're proposing. They're proposing a 4-story building, and if they wanted to propose a taller building, it would require much more parking, and there'd be significant other variances that would be triggered as a result of that. So the building is somewhat constrained by the dimensions of the lot itself. But to answer the question, commercial properties, if it's just commercial, 50 feet would be the maximum. If it's residential and mixed use, then 60 feet would be the max.
And to kind of answer some of the concerns, she was saying it is higher than all the other properties along Notre Dame. Do you know why is that? How come like the neighborings are only 2 stories, or could those neighborings actually expand their businesses and go taller if they wanted to?
Absolutely. Most of those commercial buildings are older. They're 1-story buildings. They are all zoned C2, so they have entitlements to construct up to 49 feet, 60 feet if there's a residential component. There is a 3-story older building across the street on the south side of Notre Dame near here, and then closer to the Health Science Center, there's taller buildings there. The parkade that is directly on the other side of Tecumseh here is also taller than the building that is being proposed. So it's a bit of mix of building heights. But yes, this would be the tallest building on this stretch of Notre Dame Avenue.
Okay. I don't have any other further questions. Do you have any other questions before we go back to the appellant for rebuttal?
I'm wondering if Mr. Hare could remind me, when you get the drawings and stuff, do they sort of show how the sunlight would be affected? Although this is probably not the height of that's going to have any effect on sunlight, is it?
That is something that we can request. In this case, what we advised the applicant was to consider applying a 45-degree angular plane measured from the north lot line at 0.6 feet above grade. So what that does is it establishes a 45-degree angle, and to make sure that the building doesn't project into that angle. And generally, that's a measure of thumb that we use for infill. If this were to be, say, for instance, a much taller building, in that scenario, we would likely request a sun shadow study. But in that case, we'd be talking about perhaps a 10 to 15 story building, right, which isn't the case here.
Right. So it's not going to affect the enjoyment of their backyards.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Councillor Sharma has a question. Go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We heard from Mr. Mills details around the community consultation. To me, that seemed like a very thorough process. I was impressed by what they put on the record, and I just wanted to ask the planner if that's a fair statement. It seems that they reached out through flyers with a website, also all of the things that we always put on the record that we hope applicants do. And what I heard today is that that was done to the greatest extent possible. Is that a fair comment?
Yes, it is. The level of consultation is up to the applicant. We provide some guidance as to what we think is appropriate and the most impacted properties. In this case, they did share with us the flyer that they had prepared, as well as some correspondence that they had received. I was also given a letter from the University of Manitoba, also in support. And so the way that they've described the consultation is consistent with the information they submitted with the application.
Right. And thanks for the reminder. I think it was the Faculty of Dentistry, a letter. So all kinds of consultation and reaching out. I was happy to see that. Thank you. Madam Chair, back to you.
Thank you. Yes, we'll go back to the applicant, Mr. Warren Mills, for rebuttal. Please only, you have another 10 more minutes, but you can only speak to the items that you have heard and no new items.
Thank you. I'll pass some of my time to Karen Shansky to respond to the physical points raised by the by the neighbor. I'm sure she will confirm that the garbage enclosure and the garbage containers are well onto our property. I'm confident that any waste medical products will not be placed in the city garbage pickup. The hydrometers that the neighbor expressed concern about will in fact be coming out. I checked with my log and with my clerk. He and I were both in attendance when at 10:30 a.m. on February the 13th, our flyers were placed in the mailboxes of all of the residences adjacent to the property. The concern about the privacy and the adjacent properties, we hired an arborist who did a thorough review and analysis of the 26 mature trees, albeit they're growing on neighbor properties at the rear, at their rear adjacent to us, but as well as the landscaping that we're proposing and the new refreshed and renewed fencing we're proposing, I want to assure the councillors that there are 26 mature trees growing along the adjacent property. I wish we could have had the opportunity to speak to the neighbor. As soon as we became aware of her concerns, we asked for access to her and that access was declined. And I want to say that she is completely correct. I rechecked my environmental assessment reports and the property was not remediated in 1996. It was closed, as she said, in 2000. So I apologize for that error in my presentation. And I'll ask Karen to comment to the physical concerns that were raised.
Thank you, Warren. I just wanted to, again, confirm and reiterate that the two 3-meter garbage bins, so in fact, there are two proposed for the site, are set back 6 feet from the property line to the lane, and then another 5 feet from the neighboring property to the west. So again, these enclosed bins are sort of set well within the particular site. And access is, the garbage trucks will sort of proceed south down the L lane, retrieve the bins and waste, and then sort of continue down along to Arlington. And the position of the bins in the lane, again, is as per refuse pickup, which is typical within the city. In terms of the height and what we've done to really mediate and consider the surrounding residences and neighboring commercial, again, so the main floor, again, is, the height of the main floor is, again, keeping within the character of the streetscape of the existing single-story commercial units, and then we've placed the 3 stories of residential on top of that. Currently, the drawings are sitting in and around 50 feet to the top of the roof surface. And then this total building height, again, allows for that 40-foot rear yard to the neighboring properties on the north. We have included quite established new landscape buffers, again, along this new fence line to those properties to the north. And again, as I had mentioned previously in my presentation, respecting that privacy, we have not included any balconies facing the north. Again, so it's not, we've made that consideration really to keep the private spaces of the residences that are to the north as private as possible while still providing large windows, as it were, into the units that are looking north, but again, no balcony spaces on the north. And that determination was specifically because of the residents that are to the north of the property.
Okay. Yes, question. Just on clarification, no new information.
I want to ask them questions about what's already on the table.
Okay. Go ahead.
You have determined, though, with the size of this building and the number of suites and so on, that the bins that you're going to be using will be at least 5 cubic meters in size?
We have 2 threes, so we have six cubic meters total.
Oh, you got 2 threes, okay.
Yeah.
just wondering, will you be including some recycle in bins too, or no?
Typically, what we've reviewed with waste department is that one would be recycle and one would be waste, regular waste.
Right. Okay. This might be for the doctor to answer, but like, I just want to put it out here that, like, I'm familiar, like, doctor's offices, dental offices, they have to meet when they're disposing of any waste and stuff, they have to meet a bunch of criteria in how they dispose it. But I'm aware of a place where a dental office is actually violating the rules all the time. And so I'm wondering if like a dental office or whatever gets established there, do you have a plan on how to make sure that your leasers will follow the rules they're supposed to?
Well, basically for medical or dental offices, for any actually medical or dental waste, we need to follow the rules based on the College of Physicians or the Dental Association. Basically, that is completely separate from the regular waste, where like we have sharp containers, we have like separate basically medical waste, and that's basically our obligation to actually make sure that it is separated from the regular waste. Our usual waste in medical office is just basically some papers and these kind of like office, like usual office waste. The rest would actually be separated and would be collected separately by the professional companies for the medical waste or dental waste.
Okay. Not every dentist, anyway, have you considered the idea in the lease agreement that there be a requirement in there that they follow that in case issues do arise in that the, say, dental office is not following the rules, and so that you have an ability to, under a lease agreement, ensure that they're meeting their requirements?
For sure, we'll incorporate in the lease agreement about the medical and dental waste, they should be separated completely from the regular waste.
Okay. And if there was a restaurant, just to confirm, would that restaurant be using those 3 cubic meter bins?
It would be a coffee shop, I guess. Yes.
So they would also be using that. And this will be for your designer and stuff when they were talking city waste. Was it explained to the city waste people that there could be a restaurant, a coffee shop or whatever established there?
We have discussed that with them in terms of what that would be. And again, it wouldn't be a full service restaurant. The size sort of doesn't permit that. It's really about a takeout coffee and suite would be the maximum there. It wouldn't be an A2 assembly occupancy that would be permitted in this space. So again, it would be a small coffee shop takeout would be the max that would be permitted.
So it's not like a full service Tim Hortons,
no,
anything like that.
No. Okay. No.
Thank you.
Okay, excellent. All right. I think that's it. No further questions. Okay, we're done. I don't have any other questions.
You'd like me to take the chair?
Or do you want to got a motion?
You want me to move?
Yeah,
you
can. All right. Right on. Let me hear your motion first.
I know, I just got to open up my, get to the right spot here. Actually, I guess I know the first motion. I move that we receive the report from the Winnipeg Public Service as application. I think that's the first move, right?
Taken as read, yeah.
I move that.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That's carried.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Really? I'm sorry. I can't get my voice to get down to the section. I think you should move it. Yeah. Thanks. You just have to look at the screen.
Yeah. I'll move that the report of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That's carried.
I'll move that the recommendations of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the Executive Policy Committee via the priority rezoning process.
There's opposition. You can't.
There was opposition, so we'll then go to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development Heritage and Downtown Development. Thank you, Mr. Clerk.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That's carried.
I'll put some supporting reasons on the comment on the record. We did hear from our planner that this development adds density in an appropriate area of the city of Winnipeg, and its built form is compatible with the area. I was impressed. I put it on the record earlier. I was happy, very happy with the community consultation that was undertaken and with the detailed presentation today. Mr. Kashafi, I want to congratulate you and commend you on your leadership stepping forward to develop this parcel of land and doing it with affordable student housing and community housing in mind. You shared your personal story with us today on when you were a student and you were looking for such housing. So we can see that this is very personal to you. And myself being an immigrant to this country many years ago, my father started out and brought his children here. I completely understand where you're coming from and appreciate and commend you for your leadership with this application. And also in the manner in which you have communicated with our planner, Mr. Hare, we saw that it was a collaborative process with your team, and some few tweaks and changes were made along the way, and the collaboration that you had with the area councillor, with Councillor Santos. And she, of course, brought forward her valuable comments around active transportation and other items that were mentioned, and which is no surprise to this committee. She's passionate about those things and made sure she inserted those comments during this application process. And you also reached out to her early on and before it hit the committee. And that's really the way to do things. So I really appreciate your professionalism and congratulations on this application.
Thank you, Councillor Sharma. I couldn't have said it better myself. She took the words out of my mouth. So all I can say is ditto. Again, really appreciate the great work that you have guys done to take a surface parking lot and redevelop it, and staying within the context of the secondary plan and being cognizant of the height. As we know, you could have gone potentially higher, but working with a public administration, you were able to mitigate and come to a proper solution. And again, with the garbage enclosure, appreciate you explaining that a little bit further. I think it was really well thought out, and value that you have made the setbacks appropriately and will be enclosed. Like we mentioned, there were some issues with the fire, and I know we talked about it earlier in our pre-application, and you did make some modifications to deal with that aspect. So again, I'm very appreciative of you guys coming to my office earlier on and reaching out to the community. Again, I do see on the record here how the community consultation was. You actually did send out 80 flyers. So again, that is much, much more than expected of you guys, and do appreciate that. And looking forward to seeing a surface parking lot moved into affordable housing in a very desperate needed area. Appreciate that. Thank you. With that, I'll call the question.
Before we vote, ditto.
Ditto.
Councillor Edie wants to put some.
No, absolutely. I think it's a great project, and
The applicant sounds very respectful of the neighborhood in which this new building is to be, and I think it's fine.
Excellent.
Madam Chair, just want to add, I want to thank our planner once again, Mr. Hare. We're lucky to have him. And I want to thank him for his dedication and diligence to all files, and in particular, this one in front of us today. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That's carried.
On the variance?
No, the public hearing with respect to SB concluded.
Yes, we need a motion that the public hearing be concluded.
I shall move that, Mr. Clerk. Thank you.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And that's carried. Onto the variance. Councillor Sharma, do you mind moving that?
Yes.
This one I could.
Yeah, are you?
Yeah.
Okay.
You're ready this time, I'm not.
I think I'm almost, yeah. It's not finding it very fast. There we go. Right.
You know what?
There we go. Okay.
At this time, I'll just read the closure on the item that proceeds to council. So this is regarding the subdivision and rezoning. Please note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted on the subdivision and rezoning. All persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council.
Okay.
Okay.
Mr. Clerk, in respect to the variance, I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
Hey, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That's carried.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That's carried.
I move that in accordance with subsection 247(3) of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan, does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenity use, safety, and use convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. It is the minimum modification of the zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated. Supporting comments again are as reflected on the rezoning.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And that's carried.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in.
Can the variance be approved, Councillor Eden?
And the variance be approved.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And that's carried.
I move that public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And that is carried unanimously.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Excellent. That concludes our hearing. Okay.
Pardon me, colleagues, you know, this is the first application I searched through where the word move was used several times before you get to the actual motions. So,
anyway. First for everything. Thank you, Madam Chair. I move adjournment if there's no other business.
No other business. All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That's carried. Thank you.